I'm going to begin by discussing just a very short précis of what everybody said about these two fields that really need to merge and that are trying hard to merge. So the take-home messages from the environmental health science speakers are the following. First of all, we had that incredible opening plenary from Lynn Goldman. And what Lynn really said, our understanding, she said of so many things, of course, you can hardly do justice in a few lines, but we'll try. Our understanding of toxicity has gone through a transformational evolution in the last decades. Everyday chemicals that once looked to be benign no longer do. The critical landscape has moved from the obvious, e.g. mutagenesis, such as you would see with thalidomide babies, for example, to the subtle, e.g. EDCs, such as we're now seeing with phthalates and reproductive impairments of baby boys, to epigenetics and impaired development, and to early programming of later life diseases. An overview of Lynn's discussion. Next, we had Jerry Heindel from NIEHS. Developmental exposures lead to diseases later in life. The mechanism of the effects result from altered epigenetic programming. The developmental basis of disease changes everything and shifts the focus from curing disease, our current focus obviously, to prevention of exposures and intervention prior to the onset of disease. And most importantly, there was that really, incredible slide where Jerry pointed out that EDC impairments can lock into species multigenerationally from the studies out of Skinner's labs. Next came Bruce Blumberg. Diet and exercise is not sufficient to explain the obesity epidemic. Several classes of chemicals called obesogens inappropriately stimulate fat cell development. Prenatal obesogen exposures reprograms metabolism. Exposed individuals are predisposed to gain weight regardless of lifestyle. Obesogens we know about all come from plastics, bisphenol A, phthalates, organotins. And then finally, Joe Thornton, with that lecture covering an immense breadth of what will happen in the next 100 years of study in this area. There are a very large number of cellular receptors that can be and are disrupted by synthetic chemicals. The current regulatory strategy of testing chemicals one by one cannot possibly identify all of the substances that threaten health by interfering with biological signaling. The questions are, what should we do? What should chemists do about adverse epigenetic effects? What we do know that we do not understand so many things that are essential for dealing effectively with adverse epigenetic effects. I think everybody in the room understands that. There is so much to learn. But also, we also know that we have no choice but to embark upon a systematic course to adapt the economy to the realities they represent. I think my colleagues did an incredible job speaking about green chemistry, but Joe's question on PVC, I would take personally a stronger stand on that. PVC should be banned. I go around the country lecturing a lot, and I don't go often lecturing against PVC, but I lectured just north of Pittsburgh at La Roche College about 2 years ago, and at the end of the lecture, a young man came up to me and said, "Professor Collins, what would happen if you'd spent 2 months in the last two summers sitting in front of a 55-gallon drum with a gallon of gasoline burning PVC offcuts?" And I looked in horror and I said, well, nobody would do that, would they? And he said, well, that's what I've done for the last two summers. And I have an extensive message on my computer from him. That's unbelievable. He would be definitely contaminated with dioxins. The whole region was contaminated with dioxins by that impact, and it turns out it's common. And the reason is that the small-scale contractors have to pay quite a lot of money to get the PC offcuts disposed of. It's a heck of a lot cheaper to get a kid to go and burn the stuff. PVC is, as Joe said, is our major source of dioxins. Dioxins are unbelievable. We've known since the 70s that at 5 parts per trillion, you'll hit on one dose to a pregnant rat, the sons will come out at 75% sperm count compared to uncontaminated examples. At 50, 60 parts per trillion, they're ruined reproductively. Dioxins are unbelievably bad for human health, particularly TCDD. So I think really, while companies like Dow, I believe, are truly trying to move to greener products and processes, they're also expanding chlorine. And chlorine means continual invasion of PVC into everything. PVC, in my opinion, is the asbestos of the future. So having said that, let's move on. The take-home messages from our outstanding green chemistry panel. Historically, handling health and environmental impacts of chemicals focused on minimizing exposures. Insight into the molecular base of toxicity was limited. Advances in toxicology and related disciplines now permit green chemistry to begin designing against intrinsic hazards. Earliest green chemistry innovations improved products and processes through using each of the 12 principles of green chemistry. The next phase will focus on the principles as an integrated system for developing chemical structures that are inherently less hazard and more sustainable. Our next one, of course, was John Warner. Our education for system for chemists and material sciences still today does not seek toxicology and environmental impacts as required knowledge. The large army of practicing scientists worldwide inventing the next generation of materials has no training or skills necessary to meet these challenges. Until this fundamental gap in knowledge is filled, we cannot build a sustainable technology base. John is absolutely right. We really have major work to do here on restructuring education in green chemistry. Next, we had our wonderful pharmaceutical leader, Buzz Q, tell us, large pharmaceutical companies want to minimize environmental impacts and accept full life cycle responsibility for their products. They really do. They are working in-house and collaborating to address issues. Near-term approaches to reduce PI involve more careful and new water treatment processes. I'll tell you about one shortly. Advanced drug delivery technologies that reduce API content, shelf life extension, and patient e-tracking. Longer-term approaches greater than 5 years involve designing APIs with environmental fate effects in mind. Currently, this is beyond our scientific understanding. But an incredible problem space, as Buzz pointed out, for the young people in the audience. And finally, Jim Hutchison with his wonderful talk. Nanotechnology offers substantial benefits to society and the environment. Clean water, cheap, efficient solar energy, more effective medical diagnostics and treatment, to name but a few. Nanoscale materials may also possess new hazards, and there is a growing desire to identify and address these hazards as the field transitions from the discovery phase to implementation. As an emerging field, nanotechnology is ripe for application of green chemistry principles to the design of nanoscale products and nanomanufacturing before this technology becomes established and entrenched. Green chemistry has already been shown to be widely applicable to nanoscale science and technology. Oregon is doing a beautiful job and is really leading in that effort. Well, those were our speakers. And now I want to move to the very general, and then I'll come back and talk a little bit about what we do at Carnegie Mellon, and then go back into an overview to finish up. You know, there are three big things we've got to do to have a sustainable technology base. Everybody knows we've got to have safe energy. It's going to happen. This is one of these trough technologies where the light is shone on a tube that's full of oil that heats up and that's pumped around the plant and turns a turbine. This was opened in July 2007 outside Las Vegas. It's 350 acres. It's all energy needs for 15,000 homes. 350 acres, all energy needs for 15,000 homes. Right? That's a small cow farm giving all energy needs for 15,000 homes. The second is renewable feedstocks. Now, both of these areas are really quite well funded already. And there's been immense activity in the entrepreneurial space in both areas. They're alive, they're well, they're taking off, and with a change in Washington, they're basically off to the races in very good shape. The area that's hurting the most is the area we've been talking about today. It's had no federal funding. It's very much harder because it gets in there and it knocks up against very powerful products that are in the marketplace already. We have to get rid of hazardous substances, and there's a few very easy rules. Just let's stop putting the toxic elements all over the place, lead, cadmium, mercury, etc. If it's toxic elements in a distributive technology, you're probably going to have trouble. If you have to do it, because sometimes it does make sense, make sure that you have good product stewardship. We need to eliminate persistent environmentally mobile compounds. Every time we put one out there, it seems, 10 years later, we get the bad news. And we really need to learn from the lessons of the last century about this, that that's something we shouldn't be doing. We've heard it many times today. And finally, we've got to deal with the developmental disruptors. And I'll come back to that again. We've simply got to deal with it, which is why we so desperately need the help in green chemistry of the environmental health sciences field. And just, I'll give a different view of the sorts of things green chemistry is doing. It's like a bookcase. And imagine different kinds of problems on each shelf has specific problems space on it. And I imagine that over time we'll fill each of these shelves with books of wonderful green chemistry technologies. The first is designed for improvement of synthetic efficiency. It's alive and well, it's cost favorable for incumbent industry. BuzzQ is really the national leader in bringing that into the pharmaceutical industry. And so a good example is the synthesis of Taxol. Now this is a drug that we need for breast and ovarian cancer. It's a very complicated molecule. It was reported in the bark of this yew tree, Taxus brevifolia, but it's only 4 parts per million in the yew tree bark. And that meant to be, it's a billion of the year drug now. The early preparations required you just strip the bark off a 200-year-old tree and get the little bit of material out of it, killing the tree, obviously, not very sustainable. The published syntheses when this work was undertaken were 40 steps long, with an overall yield from the starting point of 2%, very expensive. And so what Bristol-Myers Squibb did is they got leaves and twigs and did plant cell fermentation. And they were able to eliminate nearly all of the chemistry and basically get their hands on a lot of the material. This is just wonderful. That's green. I call that green chemistry in the synthetic chemistry variety. The second area is designed for renewable feedstocks. This is also becoming economic opportunity driven. A classic example is polylactic acid, which is available in stores all over the place now. That received a Presidential Green Chemistry Challenge Award. Third thing is designed for solar technologies. Now, solar technologies is alive and well, and it's very largely engineering, physics, et cetera, as well as chemistry. The chemists clearly have a role to play, but we can do some very nifty things here. And one example, for example, is solar photovoltaics. We have a spin-off company from Carnegie Mellon University called Plextronics. It has the world record for photovoltaic efficiency of a polymer. And you literally, you dissolve the stuff in a solution and you put it down on whatever, a paper, et cetera, and shine light on it and you get your electricity. Really quite remarkable. Now, there's an equator here where these lower shelves are easier to work on because they fit to the economy and people say, oh, I can make some money there, that looks wonderful. When you go above, you're talking about displacing incumbent technologies and where there's going to be resistance. We've got to get rid of the lead batteries. And I think we already may have done so, and it's just simply that there's a large incumbent industry there that's hard to shift. We need to stop spreading lead everywhere, for example. Fluorescent light bulbs are wonderful for reducing energy, but every time you pop one, you put a little cloud of mercury into your room, 4 to 6 milligrams even in the little ones if you break them in your home. We'll probably have polymers that give out white light when you put a charge across them in the future and that last simply forever. I think we already have these. Soft metal carcinogenized everywhere, if it's cadmium, selenide, sulfide, telluride, etc., it's something to worry about. And of course, we feed arsenic to chickens, which is something we should just stop doing. Design against environmentally persistent and pseudo-persistent environmentally mobile compounds. This is the things we've been hearing about. Pesticides, polymers, their components, and degradation products. Everywhere where one of those is, we need green chemists to be working in a particular part of the problem space. John is right, you won't, with these big things, solve everything with a single compound, but we pick the individual technologies and go in. Oh, an example, of course, is atrazine. If you haven't seen Tyrone Hayes' lecture on atrazine. Atrazine's crazy. 80 million pounds used, about 1% increase in the corn yield. It's mostly on corn fields. There's enough in their systems, and Shana Swan has shown us that there is a correlation between atrazine and two other pesticides and reduced sperm counts in humans, seriously reduced sperm counts. And finally, design against endocrine disruptors is our top challenge. These are the sorts of things we have to be doing in the decades to come. Now, in terms of education, the first green chemistry class was taught at Carnegie Mellon starting in 1992. We've been developing materials ever since. And we're very lucky that the Heinz Endowments and Johnson Family Foundations have given us some money, and we're going to put that on the internet for free. It has a pretty entrance site, and I won't go into it too much. We're writing like crazy on it right now, but you can see it's one of these internet sorts of things, and we're building an engine that's very powerful so that people will be able to interact with it from all over the world, and has all of these sorts of features associated with it, and it will start appearing in 2009. What we actually do in research is design small molecule catalysts to activate natural oxidants, oxygen and hydrogen peroxide. Chlorine's an oxidizing agent, and much of its use in technology is as an oxidizing agent. And the project began with the desire to just simply be able to disinfect water with hydrogen peroxide, and it started in 1980. In order to be able to do that, you have to generate a catalyst that activates hydrogen peroxide very efficiently, and so we dreamed about what it would be, and in the center of it, there's an iron atom. It's surrounded by four nitrogen atoms and stuff that holds the nitrogen on there. The object is that these nitrogens have to push electrons at the iron more than other things classically do. And what you want to have happen is you want to have this one put in water, or the iron will pick up two waters. You want to have hydrogen peroxide land on here, displace the water, and then the hydrogen peroxide decomposes on the iron, throwing another water, leaving an oxygen atom, and that's the active species. That's what the enzymes do. All throughout nature, there are these large 40,000 to 250,000 Dalton molecular weight enzymes that do precisely that, and they do much of the oxidation chemistry of nature. We want to reproduce it with small molecule catalysts. The problem is, when you put the hydrogen peroxide there, you get this absolutely vicious oxidizing agent, and it attacks what you have produced to make it, and it finds a weak site and burns a hole in it, and then the whole thing gets burned off, and you're back to something, iron and water, that doesn't work. You put hydrogen peroxide with that, it just fizzes away. All right, so this wasn't working, so what we did is, the way we got there is you design it's called a ligand system, that ring, that you think will have the right electronic properties. You make a metal complex, you oxidate it, you stress it until it decays, then you go and analyze the degradation products, very detailed work. You find that first site that burned, and you replace it using your chemical intuition with something that you think will be better, and make a new ligand system, and then you just literally run around there, and after you do that for 20 years, you get catalysts that are as good as the peroxidase enzymes, quite literally. We have over 100 patents now, and there's a company that's starting them. They have a molecular weight about 500. The prototype looks very innocuous. It is, so far, touch wood, by all toxicity tests, which is by now quite a few. Now, what I want to do is just give you some appreciation for what we do when you get something like this in a chemistry lab. And I realize I'm not talking in general to chemists, so I'm going to try to keep it sort of pictorial and conversational rather than detailed. So we do a lot of design work in my institute. We study the mechanisms of action of the Tamil catalysts, and we'll show you that they are a phenomenal way, absolutely cutting-edge way, to purify trace oxidizable pollutants, persistent organic pollutants, from water. And it basically gives us what I like to think of as fire in water. Everything happens at very low temperature, of course. And so this is just a series of papers. And all I'm going to say is that we had a problem in the early 2000s that acid knocked the iron out too easily, and we put on our thinking caps and redesigned the ligand system enough, solved the problem. Acid, now you can work over the whole pH range with Tamil activators. And then in 2004, we published a paper where we showed that not only does it activate hydrogen peroxide, it activates oxygen. More slowly, but still, this is quite remarkable, because when you breathe in and the oxygen goes into your lungs, it lands on a ferrous ion, iron 2. Ferric iron, rust, iron 3, has one less electron. This is actually oxygen interacting with iron 3. It had been seen once before in the labs of Carl Wiegert, but we went through and really did a number on this. It's quite remarkable. And then you go through and you show, you can take a dye in large concentration catalyst peroxide and incinerate it in minutes to almost minerals. And you go through and you do things like, what's happening here is we're varying concentrations of peroxide and varying concentrations of the dye and seeing how fast the reaction goes. That's the surface. And you can literally get down to how fast does the peroxide react with the iron, how fast does the reactive intermediate interact with the dye, and sort that out. So we did that. And then a very important paper, we were able to develop kinetic methodologies to also find out how fast, while all that's going on, does the catalyst degrade itself. And it actually commits suicide by two mechanisms, and you can get the exact timing of those processes. And then we found and published in Science that actually is an oxygen atom on iron. We actually can isolate at low temperature and see the reactive intermediate. And then we went and showed that you put one electron in, as happens with the in the enzymes, and you can go and characterize all of those systems as well. Here, we found that you'd be putting the catalysts into water and they'd be degrading too easily. We went and showed how to stop that with different buffers. And this paper, which has just come out in JAX, basically shows these catalysts are working comparably to the enzymes. They're working just as fast, doing enormous numbers of turnovers, but they'll oxidize everything. The enzymes often will only oxidize specific things, fire and water. And now once you've got all of these kinetic numbers, how fast all the different reactions are going on, you can actually use those numbers to think a priori about design of the catalyst and dream up a catalyst and do some quantum calculations and predict that you'll have a better or worse catalyst based on the numbers, and design now has gone to a much higher level. And so then this is the prototype catalyst. Each one of those has about 100 grams in. For water cleaning, it's an enormous range of pollutants that we destroy. Bisphenol A, many of the, any phenol, many of the things that you've been hearing about in minutes at trace concentrations or higher concentrations, if you want, are destroyed in water very quickly. Biological warfare agents killing anthrax-like spores very, very fast. Chemical warfare agents, the studies are going on, have gone on several DOD labs right now. They're going on in England. Agricultural pollution, removal of estrogens of water. I'll show a little detail of that. Pharmaceuticals, actually, these are horrible projects and very exciting projects, because we'll take one of Buzz's company's biggest sellers, atorvastatin, and you'll take a tiny amount of the catalyst, 100 times more atorvastatin, and excess peroxide, and in 2 minutes you have 45 compounds. Well, to actually go and know atorvastatin, you've got to now go and characterize everything. So they literally take years to actually complete the studies, but we're into it with something like about 10 of the major pharmaceuticals that are persistent. It's all the thiophosphate, well, four of them that we were easily decomposed, but I dare to say it's more than that, as well as all organochlorine pesticides, quickly decomposed. Problematic hydrocarbons from gasoline. Laundry, very good for stopping colors running from fabrics and laundry. Explosive sites cleaning. Pulp and paper, very good for the smelly compounds, the organochlorine compounds, and the colored compounds. Great for killing hospital infectious organisms that make people sick and kill them, such as Clostridium difficile. And I think we may have a water disinfection technology. I'm a bit frightened of that thought in case there's some hidden toxicity. And it's very good for getting sulfur out of diesel and gasoline. So we have something that's quite remarkable, and we spend a huge amount of time studying it. The company Greenox Catalyst is commercializing this as of now. Pentachlorophenol, one equivalent of the catalyst, 715 of pentachlorophenol, excess hydrogen peroxide, 9 minutes at pH 10. You can do it at pH 7 if you want. Room temperature, quench with acid, and what you see is it is obliterated and broken down into minerals and small compounds. There's no dioxins. It's a single treatment. It happens in minutes. You put it in water. The TAC activators have very low toxicity. and you can do it at pH 7. If you want to get rid of these compounds, they'll actually disappear at pH 7. It's about as good as you could ask for in terms of taking trace pollutants out of water. This, I think, is real progress for a green way of cleaning water. These are the major estrogens. This is 17-beta estradiol, 17-alpha, estriol and estrone, testosterone, and the pill. This is the one that gets through the treatment plants and hangs out. One part per trillion feminizes fish. So what the conditions are, 80 millionths of a mole. Not very much, but sounds like, but it is quite a bit compared to what's in the water. But 80 billionths of a mole of the catalyst. So that means you take 500 grams worth of catalyst, take 80 billionths of that quantity, put it into a liter of water, that's the concentration. About enough hydrogen peroxide, a bit more than is required to mineralize the steroids. pH 8 is a good water pH. Terminate the reaction when you're ready to look at it, and this is what you see. So this is estrone. It's a degradation, an estrogenic degradation product of estriol. This is falling from 100% to zero. Estrone, this is estrone, estriol, ethanol estradiol, 17-beta, 17-alpha. Testosterone, the guys are a little bit tougher. Harder to break down testosterone. And 15 minutes is what that takes at room temperature. So if you actually were treating water, 1 kilogram of the catalyst under these conditions would do 25,000 tons of water. I think we can probably get it. It's not optimized. And if you take something coming out of a water treatment plant and give it this treatment and then analyze it for estrogenicity, there's no estrogenicity present, or at least greater than 99% removal. Now we're back to the final close and the summary of everything that we've seen today. And these are my suggestions for strategies for advancing synergies between environmental health science and green chemistry to promote sustainability. We have to evaluate chemistry's and toxicology strengths and weaknesses for dealing with sustainability challenges. They're so enormous. What are we good at? What aren't we good at? Joe Thornton's Pandora's Poison tells us what we're not good at. Lynn Goldsman's talk gave us great hope, and I could have picked many other talks. I just have enough room for a few there. We need to focus on making the most of the strengths and finding ways to overcome the weaknesses. Green chemistry's design approach is our great strength. Getting rid of the weakness, let's just teach and talk about it and it'll go away. That's how you get rid of it. If you don't talk about it, it won't go away. Identify and prioritize hazardous substances for reduction and elimination. We saw this theme in a number of the talks. In my opinion, developmental disruptors are at the top, I've said that. Toxic elements, persistent environmentally mobile molecules are great places to start. Develop distribution budgets for hazardous substances across the marketplace. We've got to know where they are. Some of the places, bisphenol A is probably not a problem, and in other places, it's a terrible problem. If you don't know where it is, you don't know what to work on and how to find an adequate replacement. We've got to actually have openness on where chemicals are in the marketplace. It's going to require industry to be helpful here. Look, this idea that it's a trade secret, chemists can find out what's in anything very easily. That's an old story. That worked in the Middle Ages. It doesn't work anymore, that idea. You know, let's just be honest about these things. And public and government, we need to dig into it. I think we need to follow this meeting's leadership in joining EHS and GC researchers to bring the environmental health sciences forefront understanding of hazards into green chemistry design and green chemistry understanding of the chemical enterprise dynamics into environmental health sciences. And an excellent example here didn't come up, but is John Warner's knowledge of BPA products and exposures combined with Fred von Saal's knowledge of health and impacts of trace BPA exposures. We need to develop a portfolio of assays to ensure that green chemistry products and processes are not hazards by the standards of contemporary knowledge. Joe Thornton highlighted the complexity of the complete challenge. Work of Fred von Saal, Tyrone Hayes, and others show that the challenges are approachable. You can identify the problems. And we need to enshrine this assay portfolio in the principle that it must be readily adaptable as new knowledge comes along that says it's inadequate. That's something we just have to get to because we're too locked in the past in these things. The recent FDA decision on low-dose BPA exposures highlights the need to keep up with the new science. Another thing, once we've got these tests, we need to test experimentally with new assays and/or screens via QSARs, quantitative or qualitative structural function activity relationships, green chemistry products to increase confidence that they'll not be burdened by knowable toxicity. And we need to establish the principle that green chemistry products or processes must be quickly redesigned and replaced if a novel or overlooked serious hazard becomes apparent. We don't know how to do this with chemicals at all, but it's vital for, we know how to design, of course, but to escape these problems, it's vital for sustainability that we figure out how to move more quickly than, for example, with something like PVC that we've been talking about. We need to work to level the playing field for green chemistry products and processes by supporting advocacy for regulations where and when appropriate. The internet's here, the world has forever changed. The leading EHS nonprofit intelligentsia are often web teaching chemistry that is more important for chemists to know than is what is being taught in chemistry departments. I'm absolutely sure of that. Work together to defend non-monotonic dose-response science against forces that attempt to obfuscate it over money. EDCs are to the chemical enterprise what some private mortgages are to the financial enterprise. Environmental health science findings of adverse health effects at environmentally relevant concentrations have tectonic significance for public policy. Neither field can thrive without a healthy dialogue with public policy. A coalition between environmental health sciences and green chemistry is the next and an essential phase of sustainability science. It's not about what might happen in 2030 if we don't act. It's about what's happening now. These things are clearly happening to our children now. So I see two paths ahead for green chemistry, frankly. We're nearly there. One, it'll deal with hazards that are well understood by chemists and it'll be focused on short-term economic gain and on its own image. This will probably lead to self-contained, self-congratulatory field focused on problems that are obvious to chemists. Big achievements for sustainability will likely be rare. Chemists will feel good for a while, but the field will miss some of the biggest challenges to health and the environment. Sooner or later, the wider civilization will be disappointed in green chemistry's performance. A better scenario, in my opinion, is it'll be built on a synergistic alliance with environmental health science to deal with all hazards, including those not easily understood by chemists. Hard work to understand them. We've got to put it in. This will help industry move away from products and processes that are burdened by the new types of low-dose toxicities. It'll be characterized by a passion for escaping hazards that most threaten sustainability. It will inspire the wider civilization, leading to sympathy and support for essential industry transitions in place of acrimony. And it'll bring long-term economic stability to industry. So these environmental health science finding of low-dose adverse effects of synthetic chemicals moves, in my opinion, transgenerational justice to the center of our civilization's ethical stage. And the real thinker here is Hans Jonas in that book, The Imperative of Responsibility. If you went back to an Italian hill town in 1500, that's the city of Urbino, that Lord Clark in his TV program Civilization said was one of the best places to live in Western civilization for about 50 years. If you look at Urbino, and you were an Urbinoite in 1500, who could you really impact? Your projection of power in time and space was immensely limited because your technologies weren't very powerful. You could impact people that you meet. Now, after we had the Industrial Revolution, we get to Pittsburgh in 1936, where there's a very severe regional impact when Pittsburgh was called hell with the lid off. Here's Pittsburgh in 2000. We really can clean up if we decide to work at it. The real question is, what will it be like in 2500? And will we, the people in this room, as well as everybody else, have risen to the incredible challenges that sustainability puts before us, given the knowledge of environmental health sciences and the strength of green chemists to actually do something about it. Transgenerational justice is really the critical thing for our civilization in the next century. Well, finally, I just want to acknowledge my incredible students. This is a group of recent graduates. Several of them are in the room, Arandi and Deboshri. Another graduate, this guy, Evan's off with Paul, and Paul loves him. Chad Ellis is my most senior graduate student of 8 in my group right now. He's here with us. People change people. These young people have immense ability to get out there and make a better future for the world. We have a lot of undergrads doing research at Carnegie Mellon. Here's some of them. We've had over 50 in my group. Here's the others I couldn't find pictures for. Thank you, Advancing Green Chemistry and Environmental Health Sciences. It's been a brilliant day for me. I hope everybody feels the same. Here they are, Karen and Pete, and the indomitable Julie Jones, Mary Beth Adcock, Sarah Vogel, and Masami Kataki of Advancing Green Chemistry and Environmental Health Sciences, and of course their funders that make this possible. These are my funders. I particularly mentioned the Heinz Endowments that have been very generous to my institute, as well as all the others. They've all been generous. The Heinz Endowments is local and spends a lot of money in Pittsburgh. And thank you, everybody.